Ragadamu, my guest this afternoon, Dr. Gurun Teklahemanot, is one of the co-designers of the MRI technology. His products are already functioning in this country. But why this expensive technology in Ethiopia? Very well, welcome to this show, Guru.
Thank you very much.
Why this most expensive technology in this country?
The story goes back to, I would say, let's see, 30 years back almost. My parents and myself emigrated to the United States in 1979. And despite the fact that my father actually at the time worked for Ethiopian Airlines and had various posts in Africa, Europe, and Asia, and so forth. And
eventually in China.
Eventually in China. We had lived in all these places. And when we first moved to the United States, that's when I experienced racism and discrimination for the first time. And at that time, always...
But you never thought you would be indulging yourself in things like this one, trying to, you know, being a physicist.
Yes, yes.
And lend a hand in the creation or in the...
Yeah.
In the design of this.
As a system, that's right. So, as you said, my father had worked in China, and my first connection to China goes as early as the early 70s. And in the late 80s and 90s, early 90s, I had met various Chinese colleagues and students through my work and through schooling.
Where, in the U.S.?
In the U.S., that's right, in the U.S. And because these Chinese nationals, had various expertise in MRI and other areas, and other technical areas, and China was starting to do very well. They had these dreams of going back to China and founding companies and contributing to their country as well. So at that time, I had the particular expertise in particular magnet design. MRI actually stands for magnetic resonance imaging.
Right.
And the magnet part and magnetic resonance imaging is a key part of that technology. So I had a lot of expertise in that area. So, they had invited me to go back with them and work on these companies, making systems that are affordable for developing nations, because China is also very much a developing nation, particularly in the 90s. So that's sort of where this starts, you know, the story kind of starts. But for me, you know, like I said earlier, I'd always wanted to come back to Ethiopia and contribute in some way.
Yeah, we'll come back to that,
okay.
Because that's one of the most interesting
yeah.
parts of this interview. But I'm interested in knowing why not CAT scan, the usual technology that we have. That's about enough.
Typically, CAT scans, as you say, CAT scans and MRIs are complementary technologies. A CAT scan, which is X-ray based and uses radiation, very powerful radiation, is better for looking at hard tissue, particularly bone and dense tissue. So, for example, if somebody's in an accident, the first thing you want to do is put them in a CAT scan because you want to know if they have microfractures or what have you. And unfortunately, CAT scan works on just tissue density, as we say. And tissue density variations are very small, maybe 7%, you know, between different tissues. When it comes to MRI, firstly, MRI uses a completely different way of imaging. It uses magnetic effects. What it does is it aligns the hydrogen nuclei in our body and manipulates the hydrogen nuclei to give off signals, as opposed to an X-ray where you just irradiate the patient or the subject with just X-ray, and you look at what has passed through and deduce from that or, you know, construct an image from that. So MRI is a much more sensitive technology. And in addition, in MRI, the way it works, you could manipulate the scanner to get a lot of tissue differences, and you can highlight contrast even between slightly different kinds of tissue and bring out a lot of features that CAT scans or ultrasound or whatever, you know, or PET scans and so forth are not able to do. So it's a highly sensitive scanner, and particularly for soft tissue, you know, which basically, with the exception of the bones in our body, basically the bulk of our body is soft tissue. It's a very highly sensitive means of diagnosing and looking at people.
So is it widely employed in labs around the world?
Oh, yes. There's at least an order of 20,000 installations around the world. Typically, in the U.S., there's 30 MRIs for every 1 million person in the United States. Other parts of the world, maybe it's not as as big a ratio. If you go to Europe, on average, maybe something like 10 MRI scanners per 1 million people. If you go to China, it's still around one MRI per 1 million people. Of course, when you come to Ethiopia, you know, we didn't have any until a couple of years ago. So.
But what was your role in developing this technology? You particularly were working on the magnetics part.
Yes. As I just said, the system works by using magnetic effects. It uses powerful magnets to align. Our body have hydrogen nuclei, basically, and most of our body's water, and hydrogen nuclei in there are magnetic themselves. And if you put them in a magnetic field, they'll line up with the magnetic field. And it's basically manipulating those nuclei with various kinds of small magnets to give off signals that we use to deduce, you know, to conduct the image. My role was basically designing these magnets. There's a variety of different kinds of magnets, and was designing his expertise in how to design these magnets to manipulate the body to give off these signals. I developed these expertise in the early 90s, working in a company called Advanced NMR Systems in Boston, which was founded by students of Sir Peter Mansfield, who was one of the co-recipients of the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 2004 for actually inventing this technology. And and that's where I also met my other colleagues, my other Chinese colleagues, and also a couple of them from schooling, actually. And as I said, they had this dream of going back to China. Part of it, of course, is technology transfer from the West to China. And also, part of it is this desire to make these systems actually very low cost, because MRI systems are very expensive. They can range from $1 million to $2 million just to buy it. And our dream, again, because China is also a developing nation, of course, I, as an Ethiopian, was to make systems that are very affordable. Basically,
so you can bring them down to how much?
You know, we're working on systems that could cost only maybe a couple hundred thousand dollars. It's not available yet, but we've already brought down these costs significantly.
But your research requires an enormous amount of money.
Yes, it does.
Corporate funding.
That's right. That's correct. But so this is part of the advantage of being in China. See, in China, number one, resources are readily available. Number two, they're not as expensive as they're in the West.
What about the expertise?
The expertise. You see, that's where we come in. Myself and my other Chinese colleagues, having been educated in the U.S., particularly with postgraduate education, we all have our PhDs in you know, some of the premier in elite schools in the United States. For example, myself, I'm from MIT. My other colleagues are from Harvard, and so forth. And then, you know, we have, of course, complemented that with actually working in industry and developing the technical expertise. And so that's where the main technical expertise comes from. And then when you move to China, you can actually set up, you know, your companies there and train people there. And like I said, you can actually get you know, very good skilled labor for you know, very inexpensively, you know, compared to the U.S., maybe a factor of 10 sometimes. And of course, a lot of the resources, the raw material itself, actually comes from China as well. And then the third part the big, in fact, the economy of China is so big, you know, the bulk of our systems are actually sold in China.
Is it?
Yes, because China is also developed.
Quite a market there.
It's a big market. So. You know, you could not only manufacture the systems there, but you can actually also sell them there. So it's a big advantage. Now, what we do, and I think a lot of companies do this, even GE, Siemens, and Philips, you can sort of use that as your base to expand out into the rest of the world, which is what we've started to do. We have now sold or installed systems in India, in Russia, in Brazil, of course in Africa, and probably in a couple of years even go to North America and Europe as well.
So the machinery that you've manufactured in China, that's the ones that you brought here to Ethiopia?
Yes.
That was 2 years ago, right?
Yes, that was 2 years ago. Yes.
And it's now almost where? How many of them? We don't have the MRI system before you came into the picture. No, we do have.
It so happened just around the time we were about to install our system, Bethel Hospital also installed another system. It's a GE system.
So any different from this one?
The GE system is what's called a 0.2 scanner. That tells you basically the power of the system. Ours is a 0.3 Tesla scanner that gives you the level of the magnetic field, which in our system is at least 50% stronger than the system that they have.
Do we need that technology here? I mean.